Hello friends, well I'm back down here again at Melbourne's International Airport. We're here in the Airservices Australia complex. Now the last time I was down here and I shot that inside air traffic control video, it did really well, so thanks to everyone out there who has watched it. But I did think that when I was down here last time, there was one big thing down here at Airservices in the complex that we didn't cover in much detail. Right, I have to not get distracted by that view and I have to concentrate here because we're actually up now. We're at the top of the air traffic control tower. I've got Jason here. How are you, Jason?
Welcome, Stefan. Welcome to Melbourne Tower. Nice to have you here today.
It's so good to be here. Jason's actually one of the controllers who works here with Air Services up in the control tower at Melbourne Airport. Jason, can you just give us a quick overview of what are some of your responsibilities here in the tower?
We're responsible for all the movements that happen on the ground. So the controller sitting on the right-hand side there is the SMC, or the Surface Movement Controller, or referred to as the ground controller. They're responsible for taxiing aircraft and aircraft on the ground. The Aerodrome Controller, who's the next person on the left, also known as the Tower Controller, they're responsible for the runways.
How many aircraft, say, on the ground and arriving and departing from the airport, how many would be under your control at any one time?
In terms of the Aerodrome Controller, the Tower Controller, it wouldn't be uncommon to have two or three on final at any one time that would be talking to the Tower Controller, potentially one or two that had departed before they'd been transferred to a departures controller, and then however many are at the holding point waiting for their turn to depart. So probably five, six, maybe seven at a time. In terms of SMC on the ground, it can be a lot more. Melbourne ground is quite busy, and as you can see at the window there, there's probably up to a dozen there that have either pushback or are taxing. That will be potentially plus whoever's holding for a pushback, which is limited by apron congestion and that sort of thing. In terms of volume, our ground position is probably the busiest. 20 or more could be under control at one time.
Wow.
On SMC.
Melbourne's got cross runways here, and there's something called LAHSO, which we don't really use very much in general aviation.
Well, LAHSO is quite a unique procedure to Melbourne, and essentially what it allows us to do is use two runways for landing at the same time. In the case of Melbourne, we will use runway 27 for arrivals and runway 34 for arrivals at the same time. Essentially, runway 27 is used as a single runway, so we use that for departures and arrivals. With runway 34 being used for arrivals only. Aircraft arriving on runway 34 that are participating in LAHSO, which is land and hold short operations, will be issued a clearance to land and hold short of runway 27. There's quite a few restrictions on us to use LAHSO, the first one being weather, so we have to meet very strict weather conditions, and if at any stage those weather conditions change and move outside of the criteria that allows us to use it, we have to stop immediately. The pilots themselves have to be trained and approved, so both the pilots, the operators and the aircraft types. And then, of course, from our point of view, we have specific training to be able to participate in LAHSO and apply those standards ourselves. But essentially, it doubles our arrival capacity, so it's a great way. When we can use it, and we can use it day and night, it allows us to use two runways.
Do you have one person who's just always assigned to ground, or do you change between the different positions here in the tower?
No, we certainly change. The goal is that every person who works here will be able to operate in all four positions. As people start here, typically they will train on SMC, so ground movement first, and the clearance delivery position, consolidate there for a period of time, and then move across to the tower position, so ADC, and the COED, which I didn't touch on earlier. And the COED's a high responsibility job because they are responsible for overall operations of the tower. So they'll pick the runways that we're using, create ATIS's, liaise with external agencies. If there was an emergency, that's the position that would be coordinating with external agencies to work out the best response.
Key differences here in the tower compared to some other air traffic control towers around the country, Moorabbin for example, is with the strips for the aircraft, which identifies which aircraft are where and what order they're coming into land. They're not actually paper strips here, because they're electronic.
That's right.
Is that right?
So we have electronic representation of paper strips. The idea is that it should emulate exactly what was used in the old tower or many other towers around the world that still use paper strips. To run you through what we have here, this is the setup for the ADC or the Aerodrome Control tower position. So we have four screens, as you can see there. The screen in the centre here, the one at the bottom, is the primary screen, and this is the one that replicates what you would see in the old tower in terms of a strip board. On the left-hand side here is pending departures. So they'll arrive there in a sequence that they've called ready. When ready, they'll move across into the runway bay, which will show aircraft that are using the runway, both arrivals and departures. And then above that is the inbound sequence. So they're greyed out now because they're not talking to the tower. Once they're talking to the tower, those strips will become yellow and to match the New Zealand one that you can see at the bottom there. Departures on the right-hand side there are a reminder of the aircraft that's departed, and we can refer back to information there. It might be a weight turbulence category or to check perhaps a SID that they've departed on, or tracking instructions, that sort of thing. On the top centre screen is the airborne radar. The arrival runway 27 there, velocity 1294 is the first arrival there, so they are talking to the control tower as shown by the yellow strip down the bottom, and the dots there indicate nautical miles, so that's at a 6 mile final now for runway 27. On the other side is of course the departures, which are the blue tags, and those aircraft have departed Melbourne and been transferred to the appropriate departure frequency. On the left hand side we have the surface movement radar, so the ground radar, which gives us a representation of the airport layout and essentially what we see out the window, and everything correlates there. So once again, blue tags for departures, yellow for inbounds, and we have some other tags around there in Melbourne which are for works vehicles or tows and that sort of thing, towing aircraft for maintenance or what have you. The last screen on the right hand side is essentially utility screen. So this gives us information about lighting, perhaps monitoring ATIS. So I guess to start there, on the top right hand side is the ATIS. So information Victor there for Melbourne at the moment, with the conditions you can see. We have access to lighting panels here, which will tell us what settings we have the lights on. In the case of today, with some weather passing through, we've had the lights turn up to a higher intensity just to allow pilots every chance of seeing the runway nice and early. As you can see here, we have wind indicators, which are in the positions of the four wind socks at the airport, and they give us constant up-to-date information on what the wind's doing, obviously. And just to the right-hand side of that there, a breakdown of crosswind, peaks, tracks, and what a mean wind has been over the last 10 minutes as well.
One other question that someone was asking was emergencies. Mm-hmm. So what are your responsibilities up here in the tower?
Yep. I guess our primary responsibility in an emergency is to be an information reporting service with an arrival that's with an aircraft, sorry, that's inbound and some time away, so diverted perhaps to Melbourne for an emergency landing. We would look to get as much information from that aircraft as possible on the situation and what their needs will be when they arrive here, and then to start reporting people. So of course we have our ARF, which is our Aviation Rescue Firefighting Service on site, advise them and start to liaise with all the external agencies. So that will be the airport themselves, the safety vehicles on the ground, right through to, of course, external emergency services, ambulance, fire brigade and police. I guess from there we then best prepare the airport for their arrival. And depending on the situation, the pilots might have a request for a particular runway, which may be an on-duty runway, and of course they have ultimate priority at that point to have whichever runway they would need. And then we then once again pass that information across to the services so they can then best position themselves to receive the aircraft and help as best they can. In terms of examples, we do see maybe a hydraulic problem or a flap problem. That's not totally uncommon. And as I said, luckily, full emergencies are very rare, and almost, you know, luckily in aviation we're a very safe industry.
I've got to ask this question: is it stressful? How do you find the job, like, personally?
I love the job, and I guess I'm very fortunate to like the job that I do. I guess the one we see a lot is the weather. The weather will change, sometimes change how we expect it to, and other times it won't. And reacting to that, I guess, can be stressful at times, because we, you know, try and do our best to, you know, be on the right runway mode and to predict these things happening. It has its moments, of course, like I guess a lot of jobs do, but we wouldn't be here if we didn't enjoy it.
So back down now from the tower, back on the ground level here in the complex. I've got a couple of your questions which you submitted via Facebook and Twitter, so thank you to everyone who did that. And Jason's now going to answer a couple of quick fire viewer questions. So, so let's start with Josh. Josh says, have you got radar for tracking ground movements? And how much do you rely on that compared to actually looking out those big windows?
Yeah, sure, good question. So yeah, we certainly do, and you would have seen a little bit of that upstairs when we saw the console. So primarily the job is visual. So if we can see the aircraft out the window and we can apply visual separation, we can be a little bit more efficient. So we can operate in Melbourne right down to Category 3 ILSs, so essentially in full low-vis procedures in fog, and we can do that primarily on the radar. We use a combination of both every day, though, of course, so while we do do it primarily out the window, we do confirm everything we see with what's on the radar. So useful tool, we use it every day, and we do rely on it more heavily in certain conditions.
Paul asks, Paul said, this made me laugh when he sent me this, but he said, do you find us general aviation pilots a nuisance at any time? What's the one thing, or maybe a couple of things, that we could improve as GA pilots to make your lives easier?
Yeah, good question. Of course, at Melbourne, we don't see much in the way of GA traffic, of course, but Metro D or regional towers, it's an everyday occurrence, of course. So no, look, no one's a nuisance. I mean, I guess at the end of the day, what's our job? Our job is to service the aviation community. Look, what I would say is be prepared. I mean, I remember well, I'm a commercial pilot, used to instruct people down at Moorabbin, and remember how, you know, fearful everyone is of that first clearance, that first radio call. But being prepared is the key. You know, read your ERSA, look at your charts, ask the question. I mean, make the phone call. Those towers that have a phone number in ERSA, if you're in doubt, ring up and ask. Ask in plain English over the radio. Better to ask early, I guess, than make a mistake later.
I think the thing that I've always been taught, and it took me a while to learn in my flying career, but it's don't be afraid of asking air traffic control.
Absolutely, yep.
Because you know, there's human beings at the other end of the line there, and you know, your remit is really to help us pilots, you know, get back to and from wherever we're going safely. So, ask the question, ask it confidently, but preparation is a key.
As with everything, is the key, yeah. But if in doubt, ask the question. Feel free. Don't be afraid to. Not at all. Please don't.
Next up, this one's from Simon. The old control tower, which is no longer used as an air traffic control tower, Simon's asking, can we get the control tower as a viewing area? Which I'd love.
I'm sure many would. Look, I'm sure that'd be very popular, but no, unfortunately not. Because it is inside the complex, it's not. But I have heard a story that there was a company that was interested in turning it into a restaurant at one stage, which would probably be, you know,
that
lovely.
Would be great.
Very good view, but unfortunately not. I think it will have to remain as it is.
And then final question, this one is a silly question, but I'm going to end on this one. Andrew asks, what is your high score in flight control? I don't know if you play.
I have before. Look, probably not as good as it should be. Put it that way. I'm glad my ability to do my job doesn't count on how high a score I've had, because it probably wouldn't be good enough.
Oh, God, no. You focus on the stuff in the real world, and right. Andrew, you can get your own high score on flight control.
Absolutely. I won't challenge it, that's for sure.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you very much for your
time.
Really
nice to
meet you.
Coming along.
That's so fascinating up there. I've been wanting to go up that control tower so much, and the views from up there, I don't think it will do it justice on this film. The best way to get those views yourself is obviously to become an air traffic controller yourself. If someone is watching this as well, Jason, and they are interested in air traffic control as a career, what's the best thing for them to do?
The best starting point is to visit us on the website, which is airservicesaustralia.com, for information on the career itself, vacancies, and just general information. There is information on there about air traffic control and how it works.
Yeah, maybe I'll be talking to you next time on the radio when you're working up there. Thanks for your time, Jason.
Anytime. Thank you again.
Cheers.
Bye-bye.